Once again, we are so glad that you decided to take the time out and see what's happening as we celebrate the seventh Sunday after Pentecost, but it's a special kind of day. I know every Sunday is special, but this one, you see that I'm wearing my Christmas in July shirt. It's my Christmas in July tiki shirt. Also, Keith, look at that. Well, I mean, we have a ton of decorations for our Christmas in July here, 2020. There we go, 2020. Look at that. Do you see the tree? And do you see, oh, look at that. We've got Meg's been busy. Carmen's been busy. We got our pyramids. We've got our tree. We got altar, Christmas in July. Look at that. Flip-flops, seashells, lovely flowers. That's what we're celebrating today here at Holy Trinity Lutheran Church. Now, you know what Keith just told me before this service started? Keith told me, I guess this has all been around since 1930s. I guess it started at a camp somewhere in the United States. Some camp counselor decided to get creative. Aren't camp counselors always creative? And they decided to do Christmas in July. Of course, then the businesses picked it up because that's another marketing opportunity. But we are glad that you are here. Now, you're going to see pictures of Christmases and how this church has been decorated. There's even a shot. Well, wait, there's going to be a link. You probably already saw it. And Neil, he did a drone shot of this church. So please check out all those things. We're going to continue with the worship. And so we can begin, even on this Christmas in July, with the singing bowl. Again, we ask you to use this opportunity to open yourself up to reflect about the presence of the Creator, the Redeemer, and the Sanctifier in our lives and in the world. And so let's do that. Worship on this Christmas in July continues with the invocation. We have waited for a long time for God's hope, God's joy, God's love to shine in the darkness of this world. Almighty God,
even now we await you. In our hearts, we still hope that your light will blaze forth, banishing the shadows of this world and guiding all people back to you.
Yet you did not come into this world in a show of power and glory.
You did not shine forth for all of creation to behold.
A tiny spark, a newborn baby.
Visible to parents and curious animals.
A host of angels away from the populated areas.
Singing to migrant workers.
A sparkling star.
Guiding strangers to see what locals could not.
Open our hearts, merciful God, to the sparks of your presence still in this world.
Open our eyes that we might behold your presence in the least likely of places and among the least likely of people.
God with us. Kindle your spark within us, that together we may shine forth your light. We might banish the shadows of this world. We might be the continuation of the Christmas miracle.
Emmanuel is in this world. God is with us now and evermore.
We continue with the call to worship. God is telling a story in our lives. It's quite a story.
Full of the promises God makes in our struggles to trust.
Full of mystery and angels with surprising news.
Full of hard endings and unexpected new beginnings.
Come, hear the story. Pay attention to the angel's message.
In our hearts, in this place and time.
Then join all creation in worshiping the God who tells it full of grace and truth.
Who comes in Jesus, the Word made flesh, and makes our story holy. We continue with the confession and forgiveness. We make the sign of the cross, of course, remembering our baptismal covenant. Precious Holy One, a brief look at the news shouts out that there are many dark places in our world.
Darkness through mindless violence and injustice.
Darkness through frustration and horror.
Darkness through grief and distress.
Darkness through pain and disease.
Darkness deep in the souls of those we love.
Now let us spend some moments in silent reflection. Holy One, into these dark places, into those unnamed dark places, into the darkness of fear and loneliness, pour out your radiance, shower down your light, break through with pure brilliance until the darkness is dispelled.
And our hearts find peace, and the light of hope can shine forth again, fresh and new with this new day. Hear our prayers, we pray. Amen.
We continue with a litany. Let the love that shaped earth and heaven
dwell within us.
Let the love that created humanity
dwell within us.
Let the love that overcomes suffering and hatred
dwell within us.
Let the love that causes us to rejoice with loved ones
dwell within us.
Let the love that forgives and renews
dwell within us.
Let the love that brings reconciliation after separation
dwell within us.
Let the love that brings the blessing of peace
dwell within us. Amen.
Let us pray the prayer of the day. Faithful God, most merciful Judge, you care for your children with firmness and compassion.
By your Spirit, nurture us who live in your kingdom, that we may be rooted in the way of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
We continue with the introduction to the Word. You are the living God who sustains all life in continually unfolding ways. And now may we open our ears to your continually unfolding word. You speak to us in new and vital and imperative ways.
With all the power you have given us, let us be silent and open to listening for nourishment, comfort, for challenge, and new focus. Amen.
Today's reading is from the 28th chapter of Genesis, beginning with the 10th verse. Jacob left Beersheba and went toward Haran. He came to a certain place and stayed there for the night, because the sun had set. Taking one of the stones of the place, he put it under his head and lay down in that place. And he dreamed that there was a ladder set up on the earth, the top of it reaching to heaven, and the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. And the Lord stood beside him and said, I am the Lord, the God of Abraham your father, and the God of Isaac. The land on which you lie I will give to you and to your offspring, and your offspring shall be like the dust of the earth. And you shall spread abroad to the west and to the east and to the north and to the south. And all the families of the earth shall be blessed in you and in your offspring. Know that I am with you and will keep you wherever you go and will bring you back to this land, for I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. Then Jacob woke from his sleep and said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it. And he was afraid and said, how awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven. So Jacob rose early in the morning, and he took the stone that he had put under his head and set it up for a pillar and poured oil on top of it. He called that place Bethel. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
All right, gather around your Christmas trees. No, well, I'll let you go. You put them up, didn't you? You knew this was coming. Keith let you know in the blast. I mean, I hope you all gather around. Did you get up early? Did you go running? Did you start a fire so that you could warm yourselves? I mean, or did you put the log on? You know, the crackling Yule log that's on TV? I mean, I hope everybody's got that going. I mean, you should, this is it, the presents, everything. I mean, look at this Christmas tree that we got. I mean, this is the angel tree that we always have come, you know, November and all that. But Meg's done a little, I mean, look at that, we got flip-flops. There's a flamingo. I mean, we've got everything. We've got fish. We have even disco. Has Richard been here? There's disco balls on the tree. May must have got those from Richard. But anyway, so you got it. This is it, Christmas in July. Now, Carmen, show that one picture. What are those kids doing? They're having a good time, right? I mean, this is it. Carmen, show the next picture. There you go. That's one of the interpretations, right? We got Mary and Joseph. We got a stable. There are angels proclaiming that Christ is born. I mean, this is it. Christmas in July. Whew. I mean, you can never have Christmas enough. But wait, some of you didn't get up with gifts this morning? Oh, man. Well, I got to be honest with you. Neither did I. I mean, I know, Debbie and the kids, I would have thought they'd have a Christmas in July present for me. Well, they did. They all said good morning to me, and Aunt Rachel fixed me some avocado toast. I mean, that was really good. You know, and Jacob took out the trash. I mean, I'm happy with those gifts any day of the year. Christmas in July. Oh, I love it. You know, here's what I love about it. The birth of Jesus Christ in our lives is important each and every. Here's what I want you to do. Here's what all of us should do. Sometime in the coming week, I want you to give somebody a present. Not necessarily something that you ordered and it was delivered or that you were able to safely purchase. How about you give presents this week of listening, of helping where there's a need, of just seeing what you can do to express the love and care that you have for those people that you come in contact with. Maybe it's an email, maybe it's a phone call, maybe it's a card. Reach out and let people know that you're thinking about them, you're praying for them, you're listening to them, you're seeing ways that you can help. Now, I love Christmas, and I love all of these decorations. We got to let it live in our hearts. So Merry Christmas in July. Now go out and share the love of God. All right, thanks for coming. Well, I'm sure if your mother taught you to say only nice things about other people, Jacob in our text today would push you to the outer limits of your imagination. Now remember, Jacob was the younger of the twins. Esau was the oldest. Esau was the first twin born. And the twins, Esau and Jacob, were born to Isaac and Rebekah. And I'm going to tell you, Jacob has few redeeming qualities. I mean, he takes advantage of everybody's weakness in any situation. On two different occasions, Jacob cheats Esau of his birthright. Jacob's father, and Esau's father is very old. He's blind, vision impaired, and he's on his deathbed, and Jacob exploits the situation to take Esau's birthright. Jacob's father-in-law, Laban, tricks Jacob into marrying Leah when Jacob really wants to marry the younger daughter, Rachel. But later, Jacob gets revenge because he sneaks off with Rachel and he takes a bunch of Laban's household goods. He even takes Laban's household gods. I mean, there is nothing Jacob won't do to get an advantage over somebody. I mean, Jacob spends most of his life as a wanderer, running from his shenanigans and troubles, always looking over his shoulder to see who might be there that he's abused, that he's taken advantage of. Someday somebody's going to catch up with Jacob. So our text today that we find him in, he's trying to stay clear of Esau. Now, he's been so terrible to Esau, he knows his brother probably wants revenge. And so to avoid that, Jacob leaves Beersheba where he's been living. He flees north to Bethel. It's an unsettled area. It's a place of desolation. It's dominated by distant craggy hills. And Jacob arrives after sunset. He's only carrying what he could in a quick, you know, kind of stuff into his satchel, his duffel bag. Darkness is settling in. He realizes that he forgot to take a pillow even. So he kind of finds a rock that's about pillow size, and he lays his head under it underneath the stars. Now you might say that this scoundrel might have been thinking at this point, with his head on a rock, nowhere to go, running from everybody, that he might, you know, his stomach might be churning with guilt over what he's done. I hate to say it, but I don't think so. I don't think Jacob's even thinking about all the stuff he's done wrong to people. I don't think he has an ounce of remorse in him. He's probably feeling bad that he's lonely and hasn't had anything to eat. He doesn't have a pillow to sleep on. He falls asleep. And he has a dream, a vision. And it's awesome and it's disturbing. It's both things. And in the dream, Jacob sees this enormous ladder. And the ladder goes from earth to heaven. And on that ladder, you know, it's probably more like what we would call an escalator, right? Because on that ladder, there's all these angels. And these angels are coming from heaven and they're coming down to earth. And these angels are going from earth and they're back to heaven. I mean, there's this holy kind of traffic jam happening. And in the dream, Jacob sees this, and Yahweh, God, stands beside him, says these words. We're going to hear them again. You heard them a few minutes ago, but I think it's important enough to hear it twice. I am the Lord, the God of Abraham, your father, and the God of Isaac. The land on which you lie, I will give to you and your offspring. And your offspring shall be like the dust of the earth, and you shall spread abroad to the west and to the east, and to the north and to the south. And all the families of the earth shall be blessed in you and in your offspring. Know that I am with you, and I will keep you wherever you go, and will bring you back to this land. For I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. Jacob wakes up from that dream, and I'm going to paraphrase what he says. Wow, God's in this place. This is awesome. I mean, God is here. In this desolate place, God is here. And God accepts me. God loves me and God cares for me. This place is a holy place. And I'm going to mark it. I'm going to use the rock that I tried to get rest on all night. I'm going to put oil and dedicate it to the place, this holy place. Jacob sees the kind of floodgates of heaven open. Jacob sees all of this holy commotion, all of this activity, all of this love that's coming from quote heaven into the world. Now, what's so remarkable about this encounter that Jacob has with God, what's so remarkable of Jacob seeing this kind of floodgate of God's blessings into the world, is Jacob didn't expect it. I mean, he was completely down and out. I mean, literally, he's in a place of desolation. He's in a place of loneliness. He encounters, though, in this place, the living God. And from that day forward, Jacob says, God is present in all the world. Jacob hears the, quote, rustling of angels' wings. I mean, even if you're in the mall on Christmas Eve, you know, I got to bring in Christmas in July. Even there, God is present. Now, for hundreds of years, people have found this story to be a source of inspiration. And it's important for us. I think there are two things I want us to glean from this reading, this text in front of us today. The first is this, it's really the most obvious, is it is great and we need to be reminded of the omnipresence of God. In other words, we need to be reminded that God is everywhere. In the least expected places. Because if it could happen at Bethel, it can happen anywhere. God's presence is on the mountaintops of joy. God's presence is in the valley of despair. And God is in the wilderness when our days seem to stretch end upon end upon end. And Jacob did not expect to find God there. In fact, I think Jacob probably thought that he was successful at keeping away from Esau. If he just kept running, he could run from all of his past. He could run from all of his problems. And you know what? He could even run from God. But it doesn't work that way. Because what's true for Jacob is true for us today. There's no place that we can go to get away from, one, the responsibility for the actions that we've done, and two, the presence of God. Everywhere, God is present. In everything we do, God is watching and praying that we respond as loving children. That's one lesson. The second thing I think we can take from this is a more disturbing one. Yeah, I said that, a more disturbing one. And that's, it has to do with God's unconditional love. Yeah, many of us find God's unconditional love disturbing. God loves all. God loves all. Now we want to think, well, yeah, of course God loves, you know, but yeah, we want to put the conditions on it. And this story says, no, God loves all. Jacob, a unrepentant sinner at the time, fleeing, stealing the birthright, taking what is not his. And God says, I love you. Jacob did nothing to earn it. And sometimes we have a problem with a God of grace and unconditional love. But that's exactly why it's good news. I mean, God reaches out to Jacob, and God reaches out to us even as we are sinners, even as we have not lived in community, even when we have abused and hurt one another. God still says, you are my child. There's two edges, two sides to this story. If you're feeling like you're in the wilderness right now, if you're feeling lost, if you're feeling that the problems are overcoming you, if you're feeling lonely, rejected, depressed, God says, I love you, you're my child. I'm always with you. That's good news. But we have the good news for all people. When the good news is for us when you and I are like Jacob. When we steal the birthright, when we steal respect, when we steal someone's worth, God says, you're my child. I love you. And when we're on the receiving end, when someone has stolen our birthright, when someone has taken advantage of us, God says, I love you. You're my child. Now, we love to think that God's there when we're, you know, on the receiving end. But we also need to know that when we're not acting like children of God, we still have God's grace. I know, a couple weeks ago, I quoted Buechner. Going to quote it again. Buechner says this. God doesn't love people because of who they are, but because of who God is. You hear it? We don't earn God's love. It's freely given. But because we've received that love, we are asked to respond with a life of service, a life of hospitality, a life of reconciliation and forgiveness. We are asked to live lives in response to the love of God. When we act like Jacob, and when those who are acting like Jacob harm us. Christmas in July. Now, guaranteed, the story of Jacob will never be read on Christmas Eve. It's not part of the Christmas Eve reading. But maybe it should be. Ultimately, Jesus Christ came to the world for all people. And you and I are to live lives in response to that gift. And so my prayer is during this time, when we literally are in the wilderness, that for those moments when we are acting like Jacob, we ask for forgiveness. We ask for reconciliation. And those moments when those who are like Jacob are harming us, that we remember that God is present and that we are loved. Go forth on this Christmas in July and live the gospel news for all.
Continue with the offertory prayer. God of ancient times and future hope, we bring these gifts to bless your world with hope. Please bless these gifts that they may be a blessing to others.
And bless us with patience and faith that we may bring hope to a hurting world. Amen.
Let us pray the prayer of the church. Confident of your care and helped by the Holy Spirit, we pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. God of harvest, you sow the good seed of the gospel of Jesus Christ into your field. Help your church throughout the world to be both diligent and patient, full of resolve and gentleness, that our witness may be faithful to your intentions. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of all space and time, your whole creation groans in labor pains, awaiting the gift of new birth. Renew the earth, sky, and sea, so that all your creation experiences freedom from the bondage of decay. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of the nations, teach us your ways, that we may walk in your truth. Mend the fabric of the human family, now torn apart by our fearful and warring ways. Guide us by your mercy, grace, and steadfast love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of hope, you accompany those who suffer and are near to the brokenhearted. Open our hearts to your children who are lonely and abandoned, who feel trapped by despair, and all who suffer in any way. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Hear now the prayers of our hearts, said either silently or aloud. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Our time together has come to a close. Once again, we are so glad that you took the time. And, you know, now you're going to return to your Christmas festivities. You'll be wearing those lovely sweaters and perhaps eating some of your Christmas traditional meals. And so we want to have you get right back to that. But again, thank you for spending some time with us as we celebrate Christmas in July. And so I offer you these words for your journey in the coming week. May patience pave our path, may hope comfort our world, and may love guide our lives.
We go with patience, hope, and love.
We conclude with the dismissal. Go in peace. Christ is with you.
Thanks be to God.